Welcome. I want to just make an announcement before we get started that Peter Bergen, I am not Peter Bergen. Peter had a death in the family and so is otherwise occupied. He sends his regrets, but you've seen him enough, and he'll be back. And we have an eminently thoughtful and entertaining panel with us tonight. Just one kind of comment before we start, which is that one of the things that came up in so many center events over the course of the Bush administration was a frustrating lack of attention to diplomacy. And we seem to be focused so much on the tension between crime and war, and the way the issues were presented to us were as a conflict between, was this a war, should we handle things criminally. But one thing that we kept trying to push the envelope on was diplomacy. It seems that diplomacy is front and center now, and it's sort of taken over our events, whether we're doing something on closing Guantanamo or whether we're looking at terrorism prosecutions. And so tonight is one more of our events that takes us intentionally into the world of foreign affairs and why it matters to the United States. I'm going to introduce each one of the panelists as they talk rather than have you remember. I just want to say that there's a lot to talk about with Kashmir. There's India, there's Pakistan, there's China, arguably. And we're going to do as much as we can tonight. But our plan here is to just have you understand why Kashmir is more and more going to be in the news, and to give us all some kind of handle on it. I think you've heard many times here that bin Laden and Al-Qaeda often talks about Kashmir as sort of the other piece of what the world needs to solve in addition to the Israel-Palestinian conflict. And Al-Zawahiri recently has mentioned this as well. So although we're not going to talk about Al-Qaeda tonight, it is one of the pieces that they play with in trying to draw the attention of the world into what Al-Qaeda thinks need to be resolved. And as you're going to hear tonight, the tentacles of Kashmir, the Kashmir situation are vast and perhaps getting vaster. Our first speaker tonight is going to be Basharat Peer, and I'm going to read this because it's long and impressive, who's worked as a reporter for Tehelka magazine in Delhi and Kashmir, and as an editor for Foreign Affairs in New York. He's written for The New Statesman, The Nation, The Financial Times, The National, Le Monde, Diplomatique, etc. He has a book, which is quite beautiful actually, called Curfewed Night, The Battles for Kashmir, which has come out in South Asia and will be coming out here later this year. And he has another book that he's working on, which is an anthology of new writing from the region. And I thought I would ask each one of our speakers tonight to just begin with telling us why we should want to know about Kashmir.
Well, sort of to keep it as an introductory, whenever I found the rare mention of Kashmir in American newspapers or magazines, it was one of the given reasons was that it's the place which could become a potential nuclear flashpoint, lead to catastrophe in South Asia. I mean, that's a danger that's at times overstated, at times not so overstated, but sort of I thought maybe I should just say a few things about what Kashmir really is. I mean, there are some people in the audience who are familiar with it, and there are some who might not be so familiar with it. I mean, this sort of the modern story sort of goes back to the partition of India, you know, when the British Empire was crumbling and they left India. So we had these two new nation states being carved out, India and Pakistan, and apart from the British India, there were these more than 500 princely states which had their own rulers, but were sort of, the sovereignty was always of the British. Now, the biggest of those states was the princely state of Jammu and Kashmir. It was a Muslim majority area ruled by a Hindu Maharaja. And at that time in 47, the ruler was sort of in two minds about where to go and where not to go. And as is well known in the partition, was like there was massive sectarian violence and hundreds and thousands of people were killed. So in one of the parts of this princely state in the Jammu region, there was some such violence in which various people were killed. And around the same time, the Pakistanis were sure that it should belong to Pakistan because it was a Muslim majority place. So in a policy which has continued in various ways even till today, Pakistani army supported tribal lashkars, tribal militias from the frontier province, which is so much as news today. So it's from that region these people came and tried to annex Kashmir by force. On the way, they looted, destroyed property. India moved on the request of the Maharaja, sent its forces, and it was the beginning of the first India-Pakistan war. So Pakistanis took control of one part of Kashmir, Indians took control of the rest, and with the UN mediation, there was a ceasefire line that was established, which later became the line of control and divides what sort of a de facto border between these two parts of the former princely state of Jammu and Kashmir. One is the sort of Indian-controlled part, where I grew up and come from, and the other is the Pakistani-controlled part. So onwards from there, things moved on at their own pace in both countries. It was relatively quieter on the Indian-controlled sector of Kashmir till sort of 80s, till the late 80s. The arrangement they had was that this part of it was a largely autonomous region with kind of self-governance, and India running the defense, foreign affairs, and currency. But in those 40 years, what had happened was, because India was also made of so many diverse communities, and the Prime Minister Nehru, the first Prime Minister, he had this unitarian impulse that there should be a strong unitary government, the center should be strong, and it shouldn't be so much power shouldn't be given to the federations. And Kashmir was extremely sensitive, so for all his qualities, what Nehru ended up facilitating was getting his own cronies appointed as rulers of local Kashmiri government and removing the sort of more popular leaders. In one case, of the most famous person, Sheikh Abdullah, who was the most prominent Kashmiri leader, who was imprisoned for a long time. So we came to 90s in a situation where the original promised autonomy of Kashmir, the Indian sector of Kashmir, was largely abrogated. There were tensions over political rights between the center and the various Kashmiri leaderships or groups. And in 87, that's sort of how we tell the story, and I'm sorry, it's a long one. So there were these big elections for the local government in which the Delhi famously rigged those elections because they wanted their own people. There was a coalition of the India's ruling Congress party and the biggest Kashmiri party, National Conference. And in opposition to them, there was a loose sort of group of center-right Islamist parties, including lawyers and all kinds of professionals who came up, who didn't really have a chance to win. But those elections were rigged, and a lot of those opposition activists were arrested, thrown into jails, tortured. And a few years later, the younger generation of those arrested political activists decided to cross the border into the Pakistani-controlled Kashmir and announce like armed rebellion against India. And that's really where the Kashmir conflict, as we talk about now in the militant terms, sort of erupted in the winter of 1990. So
getting back to where you started, you said that the reason that we should care about Kashmir is that it was a flashpoint for some kind of nuclear conflagration. Why?
Because, it has been also a very emotive issue for both Indians and Pakistanis. For a long time, the standard Indian argument was, you know, we are a multicultural, pluralistic society, and a Muslim-majority Kashmir is essential to prove our own secular character. And Pakistanis, who sort of define themselves as a state founded on sort of a religious claim, would call Kashmir the jugular vein, and how it could not do without Kashmir. It was seen as the unfinished agenda of Kashmir. And they fought two wars over Kashmir, almost a third in 1999 in Kargil, And then the insurgency, which started in 1990, got brutal by the day, and around 70,000 people have been killed, hundreds and thousands of them displaced, and the other costs of war, from torture to rape to arson to psychological traumas, have been really huge. And I think, I mean, those human reasons too are reason enough to talk about Kashmir and why it matters. But it has driven India and Pakistan to war, and almost brought it to war in 2002 when, you know, there was a terrorist attack on the Indian parliament and the huge troop mobilization, and it took a lot of coercive diplomacy both from United States and England to sort of get the two parties to back down and start a peace process, which has been going on rather slowly but moving forward ever since.
Excellent. And we're going to talk about that peace process a little later in the evening. I want to turn a little bit to the terrorism issue in Kashmir. Arif Jamal is from NYU, which is so wonderful that we have somebody from NYU. He's a fellow at the Center on International Cooperation here. And he has a book that's coming out as well. Tonight is the night of books coming out. Steve, you're going to tell us that you have a new book coming out, right? Called Shadow War, The Untold Story of Jihad in Kashmir. And we're curious about, I'm curious about just how you assess the terrorist element in Kashmir and how it spills out into the surrounding countries and why we need to care.
Thank you, Karen. When Basharat was speaking, I was reminded of, can you hear me? Now it's
yep.
I was reminded of what an American diplomat who came to see me said. It was just before 9/11 terrorist attacks here, and probably Carl Inderfert was coming to Pakistan for some talks. And I said, why do you want to ask questions on Kashmir? He said, actually, when U.S. officials come here and want to talk about Taliban or another issue, Pakistan says, let's talk about Kashmir first. So whoever comes here must be briefed about Kashmir. Unfortunately, the knowledge about Kashmir and what has been happening in Kashmir is very limited. Still, if Mumbai attacks had not happened, I think we wouldn't have been talking about Kashmir in this country. A lot of people asked me during my research on militancy in Kashmir, why are you focused on Kashmir? Everybody is focused on Taliban, everybody is talking about and writing Al-Qaeda. So my answer was, when the militancy movement in Kashmir explodes, really when it goes to the world, we will forget everything. Al-Qaeda will be just a small movement in front of what Kashmir has to offer to us. Let me give you examples. We don't have much time to talk about this. Lashkar-e-Taiba has trained more than 200,000 militants. My calculations are that 500,000 terrorists have been trained for jihad in Kashmir. At one time in Kashmir, not more than 3,000 are active, have been active in the last 20 years. So what you call the sleeper cells have enormous range. The problem is that Pakistan Army has always been focused on Kashmir for the last 60 years. This has been the most important element in Pakistan's defense and foreign policy. And from the very first, from the very beginning, jihad was the instrument of Pakistan's foreign and defense policy. And this, the policy which Colonel Akbar Khan, who led the jihadis in 1947 and 48. These plans are still intact, and they are being implemented even today with a few modifications. Since the Americans and the West didn't know much about Kashmir and Pakistan's focus on Kashmir, the Americans and the West ignored this factor. And when General Musharraf said, okay, we will fight, we will be your partners in the war on global terror, the Americans believed, and they believed till 2006, and that is when they realized that Pakistan had been playing a double game. Pakistan played a double game with India by going for a peace process till 2006. Pakistan did the same with the Americans, and we have come to a very, very precarious situation. My sense is that it would not be possible to dissuade Pakistan not to follow the jihadist policy unless we resolve the Kashmir problem. And Kashmir problem cannot be resolved without international intervention, in my view. Pakistan and India have failed to resolve this issue for the last 60 years, and I don't think they will do that in the next 60 years. Somebody asked me recently, what if the Americans and Europeans impose sanctions on Pakistan or threaten to impose sanctions on Pakistan? I said, Pakistan caused four wars with India, 47, 65, 71, and 99 in Kargil. And many other, and on many other occasions, Pakistan and India came very close to a real war. And Pakistan lost all of them, all the four wars. If this could not stop Pakistan from pursuing the jihad as an instrument of its defense policy, nothing else would. I think we are short of time, and I would love to answer any questions.
I have a question, just a follow-up question. When you talked about Lashkar-e-Taibi and the sort of simmering Pakistani-Indian conflict, can you talk a little bit about Mumbai and how Mumbai, the attack in Mumbai, affects this part of the narrative?
Lashkar-e-Taiba has a global agenda. Unlike most Kashmiri militant groups, Pakistani militant groups like Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, Harakatul Mujahideen, and Harakatul Ansar, they have global agendas. In 2000, Lashkar-e-Taiba started organizing itself inside India, particularly in Hyderabad, Dakkan. And they have been able to set up a huge terrorist infrastructure inside India, outside the Kashmir region. For Kashmir, for them, Kashmir has only been just a first front. So Lashkar-e-Taiba is very much present in India, and I do expect attacks like Mumbai in the coming months, more attacks.
Thank you. Our third speaker is an old friend of the center, but he's not old. I didn't mean that. He's a friend of the center, but he's not old. He's president and CEO of the New America Foundation, one of our favorite Washington organizations. He's a staff writer at The New Yorker. He recently wrote a piece on Kashmir. He also wrote one about 4 years ago. We should have had you write one every year. He has won two Pulitzer Prizes, most recently for Ghost Wars, The Secret History of the CIA, Afghanistan, and Bin Laden, From the Soviet Invasion to September 10th, 2001, It's a very long title, but it is a wonderful book and should be anybody's introduction to understanding terrorism in the region. He recently wrote The Bin Ladens, An Arabian Family in the American Century, also a wonderful read. And Steve, I'd sort of like you to contextualize this for us. You know, okay, we see the Kashmir conflict, we hear about the Kashmir conflict, but what are its the sound waves that it sends out to the region and to the world, and how should we think about them?
Well, thanks, Karen. Thanks for having me. And one brief word about my colleagues on the panel. Karen mentioned that Basharat has a book coming out called Curfew Nights that has been published in South Asia, and it won't be out here until some months from now. But if any of you, and I'm sure many of you are interested in the sort of character of the conflict on the ground, in the valley in particular, it's really an extraordinary book. I don't say that lightly. It's just exceptional. And when I was in Pakistan and traveling on this last reporting trip, the book had been published there, and it was really exceptionally well received, because I think everybody who has walked around on the ground in the conflict recognizes in Basharat's voicing something authentic and reliable. It's a very independent voice. It's a Kashmiri voice, but it's very rare to have something reliable, independent, and also it has very fine literary qualities. It's a very easy book to read and a pleasure to read. So I just wanted to plug it because I really believe in it. So I don't know if you can get it on Amazon yet from the South Asian publishers, but you should try. So I'll try to briefly talk about the context and why it matters or where it fits in U.S. policy right now, and then I'd like to come back to the facts on the ground too, just briefly at the end, and follow up on what Arif, whose own work is especially on the leadership and the structure of the militant groups, just essential and very important. So I had this piece come out in the New Yorker. I don't want to regurgitate it on the panel, but the essence of it was that the composite dialogue, formal peace negotiations between the foreign ministries of India and Pakistan that grew up during the last 5 or 6 years, provided a public forum for slow-moving peace negotiations, but they masked something that after 2006 accelerated between the two leaderships of the country, President Musharraf and Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, which was a back-channel negotiation that produced a non-paper for a framework settlement of the Kashmir dispute, probably the most advanced document that's been produced in 60 years of bilateral negotiations. And there's a debate, I think, within both countries' elites, and certainly in the United States and in Europe and elsewhere, which sounds sort of, I was talking to somebody about it the other day, who had advised the Clinton administration about this conflict during the Kargil period, which is, some people believe that Kashmir as a formal diplomatic negotiation is best compared to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in the sense that in the two-state solution, at least until recently, there was a consensus that everybody more or less knew what the deal was. The trouble was just actually creating the circumstances in which the deal could be agreed and implemented. And so in Kashmir, this argument holds that everybody knows what the deal is. The line of control is not going to move. Autonomy is going to be essential. Both governments are going to have to invest in open borders and a sort of line of control plus arrangement, the outlines of which were the subject of this back-channel negotiation. Other people argue the opposite, which is, as with the two-state solution, even though there's an outline of a deal that everyone sort of knows is the deal, the absence of will, the absence of facility to actually bring that together, it is argued, tells you that the deal isn't actually there. So it has a kind of Escher drawing quality about it. I think you can argue it on both sides. But it's important to recognize that the elites that negotiated this non-paper, I'm convinced, convinced themselves and remain convinced that this was an achievable negotiation, and that this confidence, though difficult in to acknowledge publicly in all circumstances for political reasons, is actually resilient, and so it's present in the moment. Now, for the United States, why does this matter? And this was a bilateral negotiation. It's important to emphasize this was a bilateral negotiation that occurred in an international context and with more international American British primarily knowledge and consulting than is comfortable for everyone to acknowledge, but it was a bilateral negotiation at heart. And so we can come back to whether or not that is the right circumstance to finish it, or I have my own views about that. But just to set it in the context of American policy here in 2009. So the Obama administration is making enormous investments and taking enormous risks in a project of seeking sustainable stability in Pakistan and Afghanistan. And that's not the subject of this meeting today, but if you were to identify a single center of gravity in that project, it is the conduct and the outlook of the Pakistani security services and their relationship with the jihadi groups and the Taliban in particular. And at the heart of the risks that the Obama administration has taken on in seeking to stabilize this region lies the proposition, the question that Arif outlined, of whether or not over time, not tomorrow, but in a plausible future, a foreseeable future, the Pakistan Army can decide for itself, because if Barney Rubin were here, I hear him already saying, if it can decide for itself that it's in its own corporate interests, in its own national interests, to change its outlook and its conduct in relation to these groups. Absent that decision, the Obama administration's project is going to be very difficult. And now, I think Arif is correct. I think it was Arif who said that that cannot occur unless Kashmir is settled. You cannot get that change in a sustainable way. I think it's broader than Kashmir. I think it's ultimately what you're the stability in the region, a stable, modernizing, constitutional Pakistan at peace with itself and its neighbors, a stable Afghanistan with the prospect of constitutional pluralism. Neither of those things is possible in the medium run without normalization between India and Pakistan. And one of the dangers, and I'll just close the kind of geopolitical piece of this, I think one of the risks in American policy as it approaches the problem of the Pakistani security services and their conduct is a question of ambition. If what you decide to focus on, to use all of your carrots and sticks to achieve, is incremental improvement in the observable conduct of the Pakistani security services. We're going to hold you accountable. We're going to monitor your communications. We're going to watch your activity on the border. We're going to speak to you in private. We're not going to embarrass you, but we're going to try to condition our engagement with you around incremental improvements in your conduct in this field. I think that's ultimately a losing hand, because the Pakistani security services have been playing that negotiation very effectively for a very long time. And in any event, it's just another version of the old policy to them. Ultimately, the ask, to use that phrase, the ask of the Pakistan army is normalization with India. And normalization with India is in their interest. It's in the interest of every Pakistani. It's in the interests of every Pakistani institution. But the Pakistani government is going to have to decide that there is a version of normalization that comes with economic prospects, doesn't come with the surrender of sovereignty or the surrender of the defense of the nation or its borders, that's in their interest. So we can come back to all of that. That's my sense of the geopolitical context. Just one quick word about the militants themselves and the narrative of political violence on the ground in Kashmir, but I think on the Pakistani side of the border in particular, and in episodes like not just Mumbai, but the events in Lahore recently, it's important. And as Kashmir nerds, we could probably spend 2 hours talking to you about the incremental history of various Kashmir militant groups. But what's important as a theme is that the outlook and tactics and strategy of these groups and their relationship with the state in Pakistan and their relationship with each other is dynamic. It's changing all the time, of course. So, and the history of this bears this out. There have been many phases, and Basharat's book is particularly good at giving you the texture of the rise and fall of the JKLF, for example, early in the rebellion. But Lashkar right now is in a very dynamic phase. Their world has been changing over the last couple of years. Yes, they may have always had a global agenda, but for reasons to do with their internal dynamics and their relationship with the Pakistani state, they did not pursue that global agenda the way they're apparently having discourse about it now. The tethers that contained them to some extent have been snapped. And there is something else that's happening in this dynamism, which is that the Punjabi-based groups, their younger volunteers have taken their own path, ended up in the basement of the Red Mosque and up on the frontier, and there's a sort of a morphing and a series of interconnections that are new, that have to do with events in the last year or two. So I'll stop there. And Arif can give us more chapter and verse about that. I'd be interested in his views.
I want to turn to Basharat for just on this one issue that we can take off the table, and I just want to hear your opinion on it, because both speakers mentioned, obliquely or not, the question of intervention. In other words, do you see it, as Arif does, as needing international intervention, or do you see it as something that can be handled in a more contained way?
I think what's happening is that India has a history of saying there'll be no outside interference in its affairs, and would describe Kashmir as an internal policy matter. But apart from the rhetoric that has been changed, what was very clear after the Bombay attack was that FBI was there, American officials were very seriously involved in the whole probe and the way they put pressure on Pakistan. And so America has been involved, whether it was 2002, after the parliament attack, the whole de-escalation. I would see Richard Armitage on TV more than Amitabh Bachchan, those days. So a lot was going on. And in some ways, they have to maintain that, because India doesn't only deal with sort of what do we have to say officially to Pakistan, but it's also a question of the impact Kashmir has on domestic politics in India. It's a multi-party democracy which is really argumentative. So any political party cannot be seen as caving in on Kashmir. Although the sort of the Indian public per se, at least sort of the middle class and upper middle class, is far more nuanced on Kashmir now and more accepting of the failures of their own state and looking within, which also comes from a certain confidence of the country growing in economic stature, its goodwill in the world. But I think, there might be that sort of official cachet from India that, we saw on Ambassador Holbrooke's, mandate. First, initially, everyone sort of expected it would be Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Kashmir. And there was a big lobbying effort in Washington. Indians, put in all their guns there and said, you cannot have Kashmir officially there. But that doesn't mean that they're not talking. And the fact, what Steve talked about earlier about back channel, and there is that seriousness, and it's not only, there's a realization, you hear this argument a lot in India, is the country is going forward, it's, a lot of people use the word Indian century, and why do we want to be held back by this in fighting with Pakistan over Kashmir? And also the fact that when a lot of terrible things have happened in Kashmir, which have a serious impact on Indian democracy, the nature of the polity. When you have a huge army and you have around 500,000 soldiers deployed in that region, what it also does is that it involves a huge chunk of Indian society directly or indirectly in a military conflict-like situation. And for the various things that happened, be it terrorist attacks or be it fighting over, like, one of the factors in Kashmir which has played a big role in Indian domestic politics was early in the 90s, like, some of the Kashmiri groups, along with killing various pro-India Muslims, targeted the small Hindu minority in Kashmir, and, you know, more than 100,000 people migrated to different places in India. Like, some people who were, you know, reasonably well off had to struggle with just the dislocation and the psychological loss, but the poor peasants who had to live in, like, extremely harsh conditions in slum-like tenements in a southern part of J&K called Jammu. And at the same time, in the early 90s, it was also the rise of Hindu right in India with the Bharatiya Janata Party, and which later formed the government and was instrumental in India going nuclear. They have used issues like that without really doing much for the Kashmiri Hindus, but use that to sort of whip up communal passions in India, which sort of spreads, you know, beyond Kashmir. I mean, it's also a country which has 54 million Muslim minority, and that really complicates it. So Indians are seriously thinking, because the costs of Kashmir are not limited to what happens in a village in southern Kashmir or how many people are killed in a bomb blast in Srinagar, the capital. So I do say that, yes, they are keen to talk without being seen as talking to Americans, but they do want to move forward.
Arif, I want to ask you to follow up on two things, one from Steve and one from Basharat. The first one has to do with your sense of a morphing of the jihadi, you know, the jihadi movement, and whether this sort of younger jihadis are qualitatively different than what we've come to understand, maybe in Mark Sagemann's work, as are the jihadis we've come to know over the past decade. And the other issue I'd like you to address is that of Indian Muslims and just sort of where they fit into the whole picture and how you see them. So,
before we talk about jihadis, let's talk about the Islamic concept of jihad. Very briefly, jihad is an article of faith among Muslims, and every Muslim is supposed to be prepared to wage jihad whenever he is needed. Muslims are not necessarily asked to wage jihad all the time, but they are asked to be prepared for this. So the jihadis usually recruit very young boys, and it depends on really the organization what kind of boys they recruit. My research shows that Lashkar-e-Taiba has more than 97% from the secular schools in Pakistan. These are dropouts from primary, middle, or even high schools. Most of the leadership in the Lashkar-e-Taiba comes from madrasas, and only 1.5% come from madrasas in the Lashkar-e-Taiba, which is the biggest terrorist group, 200,000 trained terrorists. On the contrary, the Deobandi movement attracts mostly boys from the madrasas. It's something like 95-96% of Harakatul Ansar factions were from the madrasas, and very few were from the other groups. Jamaat-e-Islami groups also attack from all over the place, from madrasas and from secular schools, from colleges, from universities. Their leaders are have studied in universities. Some have studied outside Pakistan in the West, and they are very politicized. When the Lashkar went to India, and Lashkar has been the most successful a group in recruiting Indian Muslims. They set up, established contact with the Islamist groups in India, and they have affiliations with most of radical Indian Muslim groups.
Can I ask you, is there a class issue, or is this do you attribute this to class or just to ideology? Is there some class?
No, I don't think it's a question of class, because it's not just the poor who join jihad. Very rich people, and Osama is one of them, al-Zawahiri is one of them. These are very rich people who joined jihad. But my sense is, those who joined jihad, very rich, very poor, not very rich, they were all alienated from the society. They were who felt disenfranchised. Politically, economically, socially. If somebody who goes to countries like Pakistan and India would feel that if you have some nuisance value, you get things done very easily. If you are rich, you don't have to stand in line. If you have some influence, you go to the bank, you go to the cashier from behind the door and get your things done. So these are the things, these are the factors which have led to rise of militancy.
Steve, do you want to address the issue of Indian Muslims?
I'm not sure I have much to add to what Arif has said, actually. I mean, I think there's obvious anxiety and there's evidence in these cases about penetrations by Lashkar-affiliated or Kashmir-originated networks through the student movement and other groups in India. There's a debate within Indian security services about whether to see this as the true development of independent indigenous radical cells. There's some evidence that some of these Indian-based cells have independent contact with Fatah and so forth, or whether to see them essentially as just the mainland branch of Lashkar and so forth. And when you roll them up, what you really get is Lashkar just kind of coming down into the mainland. And one of the obvious discoveries that Lashkar and affiliated groups have made is that if you send a suicide bomber into a police station in Srinagar, you're not going to get on the evening news in the United States. But if you walk into an international hotel in Mumbai and shoot everybody up, you're going to have live coverage around the world. So there's almost a kind of, by the logic of their methods, there's an inducement to come into mainland India.
I didn't give you your follow-up question from your original talk, so here it comes. James Traub has a piece coming out in the New York Times this Sunday. And I believe it's there that I saw quoted Kilcullen, David Kilcullen, who's one of the chief advisors to Petraeus. And what he said was that he would give Pakistan 6 months before it basically crumbles. Now, we've had you here before years ago, talking about the instability of Pakistan, which is obviously crucial to this issue. And I'm just interested in two things. One, how you assess the stability of Pakistan at this point in time, and two, how well you think, and I'm going to return to our other panelists on this, how well you think the emerging national security matrix in Washington, how well they assess the situation of Pakistan.
Well, I think that if that's an accurate description of what David said, I don't agree with that. I mean, that seems to me over the top. I think you have worrying increases in insurgent activity and terrorist violence in Pakistan. The country is experiencing real instability, and there is a whiff of pre-revolutionary conditions in the country that has, to me, as someone who's been coming and going for a long time, I locate it not so much in the strength of the insurgents as in the weakness of the state. The state is very weak. The state seems so far to have been unable to summon the will and the capacity to deal with the most obvious aspects of the threat that is being posed by the insurgents. And let's just take a quick survey of what the facts tell us. The Taliban and allied groups have acquired territory. They formed a Gaza-like state along the border in the agencies. They have pulled that state down into the northwest frontier province and aspects of Balochistan. They control territory. The security services are afraid to operate in some of these areas. They're intimidated, even though they are very well equipped for conventional war. And most worryingly, of late, you see inflammation in southern Punjab and the Kashmir focus groups like Lashkar and others, as I say, becoming untethered and kind of turning around and connecting up with some of the border groups in order to target in places like Islamabad and Lahore. Now, they don't own any territory in those places, so it's not as dire as perhaps the headline suggests. What is the counter evidence? Why would you say that these sorts of forecasts are over the top? I mean, remember, in 2008, just a year ago, Pakistan held a free and fair election. It was an election that, by virtually everybody's account, the army and ISI stepped back from. And it was a pretty reasonable turnout. And the results in NWFP repudiated the religious parties. The people of Pakistan made absolutely clear that they do not want to be ruled by the Taliban and that they do not want to live in a jihadi governed society. So there, you do not have pre-revolutionary conditions in the sense of large swaths of public opinion leaning into the revolution. You have large swaths of the population desperate for a state that will deliver to them the result that they wish for. And so it's worrying because the state is going to have to find the will and the capacity that it has demonstrated so far it lacks. But it's not so worrying because there really is in the Punjab and even in the frontier a popular resistance to the insurgents.
Basharat, you want to turn to this question a little bit about following up on Steve, sort of.
Well, as Steve explained the nature of the weak state, but I was recently in Pakistan, spent a couple of weeks there, just traveling in Lahore and Karachi, the main cities, and it certainly, I went there for the first time. I have an Indian passport, so you have various ideas running through your head what the place might be like, and especially Indian newspapers are very good at making Pakistan look like tomorrow it's falling apart. So with all my sort of ignorance and notions about the place, when I landed there, I was completely struck because every house I went into, they didn't even ask you for tea. They were like, what would you like to drink? And there's this other Pakistan, which is actually quite sizable. What was really striking was this, the class gap in Pakistan. In India, there's a small elite, there's a huge middle class, then there are huge pools of poverty. And in Pakistan, there's this one Pakistan which seemed exploding. The beyond Peshawar, Fatah world, which obviously I didn't even try going there. But then this huge part of the country from Lahore till Karachi, I have to say there was a cultural sort of renaissance of sorts that I saw. I met at least 7 world-class writers of English fiction, dozens of journalists, 2 knockoffs of Daily Show on TV. I interviewed those people, and the guy even dresses like Jon Stewart. And so there was this whole other world, and in Karachi where I was staying, and you could not imagine. I would pinch myself. I was like, what will I write when I go back? It really was a struggle for me to find evidence of tumult and violence and fanaticism and anti-India anxiety while I was talking to these people. And I'm a Kashmiri, I do identify myself as one. And while talking to people on Kashmir, nobody was like, we want you to merge with Pakistan. I think among the middle class, among the educated classes, there's a great, as I said earlier in what I felt in India, I think there's a great degree of awareness about how things are. And there is really this like two Pakistans, and I don't think it's utterly, yeah, there are serious problems they have. I mean, the place where the Lahore Sri Lankan cricketers attack happened, I was there a day before, and I actually saw seven bookshops there, even as good as St. Mark's bookshop here, in just that Gaddafi Central. So I think that there is this, there is the policy world where we only talk about how the place is going to dogs, the state is losing control, but there's also this huge other side of Pakistan which will keep it going, hopefully.
And can I just say one thing? When I was reporting on this, the history of these negotiations, and I was talking to people who had been involved in them, somebody was trying to explain how they had been stalemated at the beginning of the talks, and that in desperation they'd said, well, look, we can't really move forward here, but let's do people-to-people stuff because, you know, that's always easy. Everyone believes that that's a useful thing to do. This was 7-8 years ago. And so they did. They opened up travel to a greater extent. They handed out visas. And then he was saying, and so we stalemated at the government-to-government level for 7-8 years. And in that intervening time, not just because of the travel, but because of media and other kinds of contacts, the people-to-people contacts and the interaction, the integration of culture and media that occurred actually created the conditions for the final peace settlement. That it was it's actually the understanding of the two middle classes about each other that is by far the most significant foundation for a prospective settlement.
That's really interesting. So I guess that leads to the final question, which I want to ask of all of you. I'll start with Arif, which is, given the portrait you've created, which is somewhat different than just plain chaotic and hopeless, which, you know, might be coming out of other places, what are the real, in your estimation, obstacles to getting to a better, more stable, more viable place?
I think that's a very difficult question. the problem is the two countries are focused on Kashmir, and both countries claim the whole territory, and they will not change their positions unless they have international pressure. I don't think Pakistan or India will not change their positions if there's considerable pressure. So the problem is the two countries have so much distrust. No composite dialogue, no negotiations will succeed without effective international intervention. So this is the distrust is the most important factor.
Steve, do you agree with that?
I don't actually, but I think it depends to some extent on what you mean by international intervention. And I think he's correct that the distrust is there and that it's profound and that it's an obstacle. But I think that Basharat had it right when you asked him that question, which was that the idea of the internationalization, the formal internationalization of the Kashmir negotiation or not, is a red herring. That's part of the formal diplomacy. These are the formal positions of the two governments. They've been their formal positions since 1950. Every second secretary who encounters a counterpart at a UN cocktail party has to reiterate, I want the negotiation internationalized. No, it will never be internationalized. Similar requires it to be a bilateral negotiation. That's irrelevant to what's really going on, I think. And I think that there is a blended form in which international pressure is there. And I think Arif is correct if you say, could they come back if Pakistan stabilized, if India had an election? Could they come back to the non-paper and complete an agreement? It's conceivable in the next 5 years. Some people say, you know, who are involved, who are right at the heart of it, say it could come faster than that. Other people are more pessimistic. You know, it's in the realm of plausibility. But if they do come back to it and if they do succeed, It will be in the environment that Basharat described. It will be a bilateral negotiation, but there will be an international context, and that international context will be meaningful, and it'll involve U.S. policy, even though it may never be declared, and it'll require the principals to get to retirement to write their memoirs to explain what they did, sort of thing.
Well, I completely agree with Steve on this, and I'm really hopeful that there's this. India is having elections, like the parliamentary elections, in a few months, and there'll be a new government in place. And even after Bombay, like, for somebody who's used to, like, you know, almost grown up with Indian foreign policy proclamations, like, the foreign ministry spokesperson was the most hated person, like, because he really bored you to death. And it has been really cautious. And the fact is, like, under Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, they have, I mean, apart from talking with Pakistan, there's an internal dimension of what India does in J&K. And they had this working committees, and under a diplomat who is now the Vice President of India, Mr. Ansari, they have serious recommendations from a committee formed by the Prime Minister of India that there are two major issues that come up in Kashmir a lot. One is sort of which is only really the dimension controlled from Pakistan, which is sort of the terrorist infiltration into the Indian-controlled part of it. And the second question is of how Indian troops and police behave. I mean, it is really like a police state. I mean, and they have these special laws, which have been two major points of contention. It's called a disturbed area, and there's a law called Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which basically empowers any regular Indian soldier to shoot anyone he suspects of being a threat, and there's no complete impunity. Like, you won't be prosecuted. And there has been a serious debate within India and in Kashmir about it. And there's this great hope that those laws will be scrapped and the human rights, you know, situation is going to be better. And also among the separatists, like the Kashmiri nonviolent groups who challenge Indian rule there, I think there's been greater moderation over the years among them too. And a lot of them would say things like, we want to be part of these talks, you know, the talks that Steve talked about. And whenever these talks, I mean, what basically they're saying is, like, give us a seat on the table and we will, you know, not object to a decent proposal. I think some kind of a larger autonomy for the Kashmir region with soft borders, everyone is sort of inching towards that, and it's a time of hope.
Steve, I have one question I forgot to ask, which has to do with money. You know, there's been a lot of buzz around the amount of money that the United States is giving to Pakistan or about to give to Pakistan. Is there anything in that financial arrangement that involves Kashmir, or is it? Do you know anything about that?
Well, this is legislation that has yet to be presented even to the Congress, never mind passed. But if you look at the outline of the Biden-Lugar bill that precedes the prospective legislation, there's likely to be an effort to define a relationship between U.S. aid and the conduct of the Pakistani security services. In other words, a regime of accountability that stops short of full conditionality or sanctions or the public embarrassment of the Pakistani government, but that nonetheless insists on greater accountability. And you saw in the president's announced policy an effort to universalize those principles, so benchmarks, and they apply to Afghanistan, and they apply to Pakistan, and they apply to the United States, and they apply to our U.S. aid delivery. And so that sounds like a healthy way in a difficult circumstance to create a path to accountability in Pakistan. But I'd just say one thing about that money. $1.5 billion a year is the ask for the Congress. Who knows in this environment what will emerge. The real crisis in the region has not to do with that level of aid. It has to do with balance of payments and the coming pressure on the Pakistani state to fund itself. So they've reached an agreement with the IMF that I think is $7.5 billion, but I think it's quite reasonable to estimate, as I've seen somebody do recently, that the total amount required to just maintain the condition of the Pakistani state as it is now, and to some extent Afghanistan is part of this, is in the range of 30 to 40. So as Everett Dirksen used to say, that's, you know, that's real money.
It's time for your question. So if you could raise your hands, we'll figure out who's going to wait for the microphone and identify yourself. And
thank you. I'm John Halpern. I'm a filmmaker, and I was in Kashmir about a year ago. And I was removed from Kashmir because I was filming there without the professional visa that is normally required, but very difficult to obtain. I have a couple of questions. One is, if an international...
One question, pick your best.
If an international intervention is necessary, how is it possible for an intervention to occur without information about Kashmir being more accessible to the rest of the world?
Thank you.
That's for you.
Is it a question?
It's a question. Do you think that let me rephrase the question this way. Do you think that absence of information is a problem? Do you think we're not getting information? Do you think?
Before I came to study or live in New York, you know, there's a lot of information about Kashmir in India and in Pakistan. Because just for the nature of the fact that like 50 Indian newspapers would have correspondents based in Kashmir. I mean, as a journalist, I might not think all of that is, you know, great reporting or the best possible information you could get. I mean, that's more about practice of journalism. But in terms of the amount of information that does come out of there and is now, at least in the post-internet world, available on the net, is huge. I mean, if we are looking at information in terms of New York Times, one story, 800 words every year. But that's true. I mean, there may be like there was one 4,000 word piece in the Times magazine 10 years ago, and I think Steve's piece is the most comprehensive, detailed piece in mainstream American media. But that's true of American media for a lot of other places.
Any more questions? Identify yourself. Keep it short.
Jerry Skolnick. I teach at the law school. Who controls the nuclear weapons in Pakistan, and how safe are those controls?
Steve, would that be you?
The Army has set up a command that it says controls the nuclear weapons, and that has reformed itself since the discovery of AQ Khan's activities. They brief the security regime in this command all the time to Western interlocutors. They describe a dedicated security force and a system of command and control that includes physical separation of materials and so forth. I have no independent way to judge the representations that this command makes about its security system, but I know that American officials have been persuaded that it is a professional command that is engaged in professional security practices. The problem is that that command is tied up with the integrity of the Pakistani army and the Pakistani security services and the legitimacy of the Pakistani government. So in a broader sense, it has to do with the integrity of the state, perhaps not so much to do with Hollywood-style particular sources of vulnerability to theft at the moment.
Another question with the green sweater.
It's a joy, Vajra. I'm not sure I follow Mr. Coll's suggestion that the Pakistani military and ISI have an interest in normalizing relations with India, other than perhaps referring to the effect and consequences of U.S. pressure or an evident willingness to put national interest ahead of institutional or personal interest. But my question is a request that he elaborate on the model that emerged during the back channel communications between India and Pakistan recently, and whether going forward his feeling and perhaps of anyone else on the panel is that in terms of realistic likelihood of India and Pakistan being able to substantively discuss this issue, that that remains the best option, or is there another model that has not yet been used that, that remains out there, even though it may be more theoretical than practical?
Thank you.
Well, on the first part of your the statement, I mean, I think it's an open question. You can construct an argument as to why it might be in their interests, but there's no evidence that the corps commanders or the bulk of the high command of the Pakistan Army has embraced that argument. Around the non-paper negotiations under Musharraf, perhaps coerced by him, they did endorse tentative participation in those talks, but they never proved the case. The argument for it would be the model of military adaptation to civil-military relations and the rewards of economic growth available quite plainly to the Pakistan Army and Turkey and Indonesia and elsewhere. So they don't need the United States to tell them what the model for normalization looks like. In Turkey, you had very troubled relations between the army and the civilian politicians. They were negotiated into a standstill, and then the rewards of economic growth, legitimacy, prestige, and regional influence solidified that agreement, at least until now. So that's the model. As to whether there's another form of negotiation other than the direct back channel that would have a higher potential for success over the next 5 years, I'd be hard-pressed to imagine it, because the Indian government that invested in these negotiations briefed the BJP throughout. And while, as with the nuclear deal, you could expect that whichever party was in power that engaged in those negotiations would be opposed by the loyal opposition in public. In fact, there's a consensus, I believe, that there is an achievable deal and that there's a competition between the two main political formations in India as to who will get credit for it. The BJP's resistance to Congress negotiations will, I'm sure, be robust in public, but although there's still uncertainty about what the next generation of BJP leadership will look like and whether it will be radical or whether it will be more centrist, I do think there's a consensus that's available to go back to these talks. And I think it would be very difficult in the Indian political system to attempt some other kind of approach, like a conference or some other formal internationalization. And I on the Pakistani side, I think they'll do everything they can to bring the United States and Britain in, but it will likely be informal as well, and their interests lie in going back to this status quo. One last thought. I mean, all of the principals who were involved in this leading up to 2007 are themselves uncertain as to what the other side would do if they ever came back to the negotiation. Would they actually pull the non-paper out and start again, or would they try to renegotiate? So we'll see.
More questions up here in the front row.
Ms. Coll, a question again about the specifics.
Identify yourself, please.
My name is Aditya, and I'm a cancer researcher at NYU Medical. Question in regards to the actual mechanism, which you had, you know, described very well in your paper, as well as the NPR piece that you did. Eventually, if you think about, I mean, pragmatically, my question is that it all comes down to the fact that Pakistani terrorist groups, as Mr. Arif has pointed out, still present an imminent threat and risk to India. This will not change. So I'm wondering, realistically, how is any country supposed to set up, you know, mechanism when this exists?
Just so, before you answer, I want to say that these are questions, you know, these are hard questions, and they're questions that people are being asked at the highest levels, whether it's Petraeus or Holbrooke, whoever it is. So we're sorry that you have to answer them, but you're standing in for all of them.
Well, I think it's a good question. I think that the prospects for revival of serious negotiations over Kashmir are right now dependent on the evolution of greater stability and greater strength in Pakistan. You cannot right now, with the degree of fragmentation of power and the evolution of political violence in Pakistan, expect India to have a negotiating partner that is coherent enough to deliver in the ways that you suggest. The framework agreement, even in the more stable period of late Musharraf authoritarian rule, always contemplated a stepped process in which the performance of the Pakistani state would be an issue. And it was not, I don't think, hostage to every independent act of violence that a terrorist group might carry out, but it was structured to evaluate whether the Pakistani state was doing everything within its capacity to reduce or eliminate terrorist violence. That still seems to me the proper metric, if you're serious about normalization. And so then if you say, well, all right, let's from quarter to quarter judge whether the Pakistani state is doing everything within its capacity, what do you look at? And that is at the heart of the dilemma that the United States faces in its engagement with the Pakistani security services today. I would just mention one thing that was present in the negotiations and that I think is pretty convincing. The line of control and the border between India and Pakistan is one area where the Pakistani state's authority is pretty well uncontested. If you've wandered along the line of control, you know that the 5 miles on the Pakistani side is essentially an exclusion zone. Nobody goes there who it doesn't have the permission of the army. So you can argue about whether the security services are capable enough to control terrorist violence in Lahore, but you can't argue that they're too weak to stop infiltration, that they're too weak to stop ceasefire violations. So there are observable metrics that you can use to judge whether or not there is will. And then, where there's will, everybody, including India, has an interest in being patient and building capacity.
Arif, I want to get you in on this. Do you think there are observable metrics? And I mean, that's actually something that we can make accountable. And is it just way too difficult to do, or do you think we can accomplish that?
I think that if the Kashmir conflict continues, there is a serious danger of nuclear weapons falling in wrong hands or Islamist military officers trying to use them. I always say that when you spend a few years in the Pakistan army, you become a jihadist. But by that I mean using jihad as an instrument of foreign policy. Reagan also used this. President Reagan also used this. He wasn't Islamist. And I remember Reagan having said about Mujahideen that they are the moral equivalent of the founding fathers of the United States. So you don't have to be Islamist to be a jihadist in that sense. But there are few who are really Islamist and jihadists. They are the real danger. When the eve of 9/11, there were three generals who were jihadists. Before that, one of the ISI chiefs, General Javed Nasir, was a jihadist. He was so fired with Islam that he started jihad in China, Pakistan's only ally. And then he was told, go easy, man. they are the only protectors. So the danger is real. The danger doesn't come from nationalist jihadists in the army who are using this, but when the tiny minority takes over, we don't know, because the army has been indoctrinated since 1976, and in next 2-3 years, the generals who will take over Pakistan army were recruited under Ziaul Haq, who had started the Islamization process in the Pakistan Army in 76. So this is my analysis.
Okay, Basharat, what you need to do is to give us some sense of direction. I mean, in terms of, is there movement? Has this changed? Do you really think this is changing towards the direction that Steve talked about? And just what's your assessment?
I would agree more with Steve on this. And the point that Arif made about, you know, what he's talking about, sort of the composition, like who forms the Pakistan Army, like it's not the old, like, British-influenced, colonial, you know, Western-educated old soldier, but that there's a new, I mean, in some ways, army is the only middle class that Pakistan has, where a peasant boy can go through the ranks and go up to be a general. A lot of them are Islamists. But I think that, you know, if somebody does rise up the ranks, and even if he's an Islamist, that there are, it's not that easy for these, for nuclear weapons to fall into somebody's hands. And also that with power do come certain responsibilities. Like, if nothing, just the personal lure of power, like just being the general of the army, you don't want to, like, destroy it all. I mean, just the perks. I mean, there are two private airlines in Pakistan, which I just discovered while at Karachi Airport. One of them is run by the army. I mean, they have huge financial stakes, if nothing else. So even if, I think even out of selfishness, army will not let things completely fall apart.
Right here.
Well, for your very eloquent presentations. I'm Alan Hyman from Columbia's Medical School. One of the changes in the landscape is the new administration in America. While he was campaigning for president, Obama favored going after the Taliban even when they retreated into the Northwest Territories. He has now made it clear that he's moving attention from Iraq to Afghanistan, and tens and tens of thousands of American soldiers will be transferred or sent to Afghanistan. What do you think is going to be the influence of this new change in American policy?
Let's start to my left and go this way.
I think the person best equipped to answer that question is Steve, so I should pass.
They're all going to defer to you, so just do it.
Say something that will be useless.
Well, so the new policy has several core principles, and some of them have to do with Afghanistan, and some have to do with Pakistan, and some have to do with both. I'll just quickly list five and then make an estimate about how effective they might be. Maybe I'll get to five. One is to see the problem as the Taliban do, which is to say as a regional problem, one that pays little attention to the border between Pakistan and Afghanistan, and to address the problem in U.S. approaches that has stovepiped all of our policies into two national buckets, and then on the Afghan side fragmented them further through the NATO command structure. So to try to take a unified view of the area where the political violence is occurring and to construct policies on the basis of that unified view. Second, to improve and to reconceive and to improve the project of population security in Afghanistan, to use the professional army phrase, but which is to say to fix aid delivery, to be smarter about distinguishing between counterterrorism and counterinsurgency policies, to stop raiding Afghan houses indiscriminately in pursuit of international terrorists who no longer reside in Afghanistan, and so on. Third is to use regional diplomacy, and really even that is too small a phrase, because the diplomacy that's required to try to reinforce this project of stabilization includes Russia and China and Saudi Arabia and others, and as well as the neighbors, Iran and India and Uzbekistan. Fourth, to see the economic crisis for what it is, which is a potential source of extraordinarily rapid instability in an already unstable situation. The economic crisis, as this country is discovering, has its own calendar, and it is moving at breathtaking pace. And the effects that it could have on urban populations in Pakistan, for example, are not something that's going to wait for Congress. This is the next 6 months you're talking about. And so you're going to need to take this emergency on for what it is. And then finally, I think there is a recognition that, and this grew out of the policy review, that the hardest problem and the most important problem lies in the outlook and the conduct of the Pakistani security services. And unless you create conditions in which that conduct changes, it's going to be very difficult to stabilize either country. And you know, my own impression as someone who's been working on this subject for a long time, especially in the context of American policy, is that for the first time during this review, the American system really bore down on the problem of Pakistan, really went at it in a realistic way. And as a result, I think the policymakers have reconceptualize the problem correctly for the first time in a long time, in part just by paying attention to it at the level of depth that they did. The problem is that just because you've now conceptualized the problem correctly doesn't mean it's gotten any easier. And so the engineering problem, it may be beyond the capacity of the United States or anyone else. It's certainly going to be very, very difficult.
My name is Pia. I'm at the NYU Department of Politics. I'm a graduate student. I have a question for Mr. Pierre. When we hear about the Kashmir situation, we always hear about what India wants or what Pakistan wants. But what we don't always hear is, what do people in Kashmir want? And I understand that's a complicated question, because there's people who want to be with India, and there are people who want to be with Pakistan, and then there are people who demand independence.
Well, you have the answer.
But there's a lot of people who also think that what they want is just basic needs to be fulfilled. So being from Kashmir, could you just elaborate on that a little bit more?
It's not really a monolith. Like, if we sort of, when we talk in terms of resolution, then we talk about the whole Kashmir region, and it has Muslims, it has Hindus, it has Buddhists, it has Sikhs, but the majority of the population remains all put together Muslim. And overwhelmingly in the Kashmir Valley, like, which is sort of the heart of the region, though one of my friends here might disagree, but I think the dominant sentiment in Kashmir among the Kashmiri Muslims has been sort of that of opposition to Indian rule. And at one point it was pro-Pakistan, but I think it's more or less about people basically just want to be left alone. It's sort of a negation of both India and Pakistan at one level. And there are people who'll be happy to be with India, and there are people who would be happy to be with Pakistan. But to give a definitive account of that, but largely, I would say the majority in Kashmir Valley and some of the areas would go for an independent Kashmir. And in various other pockets, there'll be different results.
We're going to end it here. Let me say a few things. I like what Steve said about the sort of you can conceptualize it, but that doesn't have anything to do with acting on it, except he said it more eloquently. And I think actually this is going to be one of the real challenges of this administration. They have people like the panelists assembled here and a number of people we've had at the center who have given many years of their lives to think about these issues and who think about them as well as they can with the information they have and who are being listened to. And we're listened to somewhat by the last administration, but this is a new beginning. And how you take all of these thoughts and understand their regional context and their global context is going to be the challenge. And so we're going to keep trying to help you out to understand them. So join me in thanking our panelists, and thank you for coming.